Hello? Okay. So, anyone have ever used Eclipse? Ah, you have an audience, right?
Wow, brilliant.
Emily will tell more about it. Ask her any questions. You have a link there, and you can also provide her feedback and ratings. I'll be here for reading the questions. Emily.
Okay, thank you. Good afternoon, everybody. So, how many of you have been to Java 1 this year? Yeah, brilliant. Got a few. Have you heard of the Eclipse macro profile in Java 1? If you have been to Java 1, and you will have heard of the Eclipse macro profile. And this is a new community. The one I say is new is kind of is 1 year old. So in this talk, we talk about how to use Eclipse macro profile to design your cloud native Java microservices. So how many of you are Java developers? Brilliant, we love you. So I tell you, I mean, how can you stay in your job and still doing the new fun stuff? Okay, so what are microservices? And there's a lot of definitions. And if you have been to the Fred talk this morning, and you will get some rough idea. Basically, microservice is small, like a single function. It's very, very small and very easy to release. And it has its own release cycle. And you can fix a bug and push it to the cloud and without impacting some other things. So you do not need to like worry about, you will break something else. So it's it's microservices. So it's and they are loosely coupled, and there are a number of them can form a bigger system. So that's microservices. And there's some best practices for building the good microservices. So have you heard of the 12-factor app? Written by Martin Fowler. So it's a talk about how to do the good microservices. So I list a few, things, and you need to pay attention to when you design your microservices. So you need to make sure your microservice is configurable. So basically, you do not hard code anything. You should think about how can you configure your microservices in the different running environment. And also fault tolerance. So you need to make sure, if you call into another microservice, you need to make sure you plan for the failures. That's when that service is not available, how can you cope with it? And make sure your microservice is monitorable. So basically, you can monitor, how well the microservice is doing. And you should have signal how well you are, so that if the microservice is not healthy, it's underneath the platform, Kubernetes can issue a command and kill this pod and then start a new one. One big thing is with microservices, because you want to make sure it can work in the cloud. Basically, you deploy to the cloud, it continue running. And how to build the microservice right way? The answer is to use the best practices and to use the best programming model for building microservices. The answer is Eclipse macro profile. Also, it's Eclipse macro profile. Why is it called Eclipse macro profile? It's just because it's under Eclipse. It's open source. It's a kind of open community. Everyone can join. And it's under the Eclipse Foundation. So that's why it's Eclipse macro profile. So how many of you have heard of the Eclipse macro profile? OK, a few. Good. Let me try to see. Okay, so the Eclipse macro profile is a community. So basically, it is started by IBM, Red Hat, LDC, and also Payara, Tommy Tribe, and also we came together with some individuals, and they don't work for any companies, like they work for themselves, like John Ahmed or Mark Struberg, and so on. And everybody is equal. Basically, if you join today, and your idea will be heard, and you can join discussion straight away. So the place to join is just log on to the microprofile.io and then click join the discussion. You can immediately post any discussions there, and people will join in and discuss with you. Why I cannot control this anymore? I cannot control this anymore.
And,
so this
okay.
One.
Yep.
But this is not sync up. Okay, so this is some communities and individuals like Payara, IBM, Red Hat, Kumluz, Tommy Tribe, Sujava, and it's still growing. So basically more and more companies and individuals started to join. And I think it's David in the morning talk about Java EE 8. And so it's Java EE 8 was governed by the GCP. And Eclipse macro profile is all community based. So everything is open source. And we do incremental releases. And it's a community control the base. Basically, it's everything open, and the community will say, oh, we are going to release this specification, and we go ahead to do it. And later on, I'll show you how quickly it can be released, and et cetera. So it's nothing, I mean, against Java EE, but the cadence of Java EE 8 and 7 is a bit slow for developing microservices. If you have some idea and you wait for a couple of years and then your specification can be released, but it's not the current way we want to do the microservices. So that's why we come up with this idea, like we want to do the we want to develop a programming model for microservices. We want to release fast and release more frequent. So in 2016, we released the microprofile 1.0. And then this year, in August, we released microprofile 1.1. And then just before Java 1, we released microprofile 1.2. And I will go to more details in the next few slides. And then just like this week, we are talking about release microprofile 1.3. So, and also we are thinking about microprofile 2.0 as well. So in the microprofile 1.0, we released in the June 2016, and it has three things in it. So both all of them are Java EE 7 features, like CDI 1.2, JSONP, and JAX-RS. So when we say we released this, and we also make sure like different application servers, like WebSphere, LibT, and Payara, and Tommy Tribe, Tommy EE, and also Wildfly implement this as well. So that's why we're pushing for this is because we want the microservices you developed can continue running in the different containers, in the different applications, and they can deploy to the cloud without any issue. So this is in the August this year, we released this. So in the microprofile 1.1 release, we have the config. Basically, we offer the MacroProfile config is to enable externalize your configuration from microservices. Basically, you can have in the development stage, you can like give it some values or some properties, but in the different running environment, you can free to configure the value, and then your application can automatically get hold of the new value. So this is a config 1.0. So this is the why. So it's we want to configure it. We configure the microservices without breaking it up, without repackaging the application. And we specify this MacroProfile config is to offer the opportunity for you to directly get hold of the value. So where the value is specified, they are specified in the config sources. So all the config sources are kind of layered as well. They have ordinal value. Basically, they have priorities. And then you can do the programmatic lookup or use the CDI direct inject to it. So this is a snippet. You can see how easy it is to use. The best practices in the MacroProfile is we're trying to base on CDI a lot. So basically, all the programming model has to think about CDI, trying to make it very simple to use. So as we know, CDI is kind of static. So when your application started and the value you get is fixed. So if you directly use the first injection, you will get the value. That value kind of static. You know that value cannot be, even though you change the value, but that without application being restarted, the value will stay the same when the application started. And the second one, the dynamic config. If property you know is going to change, and after your application started, so you can use the provider pattern, but that's all CDI provided. So in this diagram here, I just trying to show. This is the two blocks of all config sources. So you can in the WebSphere Libty or OpenLibty, you can specify the MacroProfile-config.properties in the application and the meta-inf, but it has a low priority. And then later on, you can overwrite in the by the system config, like bootstrapping the properties or system environment. So they will take a higher they will overwrite the ones prefixed in the application. So in this way, when you design the application, you can give it a dummy value, and when in the deployment, and the DevOps can directly overwrite that value. Like if you develop to Kubernetes, and you can directly specify the value in the config map, and then you automatically feed into your application. Just before Java 1, we released these five new things in the MacroProfile. We updated the MacroProfile config with the next version, the config 1.1. So, and then also we introduced the fault tolerance and DWT health check metrics. So the metrics is used to monitor your microservices running. The health check is kind of to monitor whether your microservices, the underneath port is still alive or not. And and also the GWT. So five new things are released after the MacroProfile 1.1 release. It's only like two months. So I personally led the config, MacroProfile config and fault tolerance. And led by IBM. And also, this is also the community effort. I work with Red Hat, with some individuals. We have we have weekly calls, and et cetera. We discuss issues all on GitHub. And also is the DWT health tech metrics being led by Red Hat, but IBMers and also individuals, so we all work together to get them released. So this is kind of full details of this programming model. So basically, this is very essential things to use to build good microservices, Java microservices. So you should use config to configure your microservices, and you do not hard code any values, and make sure you can always specify the values in a property and then directly inject them. And also the fault tolerance, and later on I can demo some code and to see how to achieve the fault tolerance aspect. And also the health check and metrics. And the GWT is kind of the original idea is because the microservice can run in the different application server. How can you make sure your microservice from one application server can directly be able to work with the other microservices in a different container? For example, one is from Libt running in OpenLibt, the other one running in Wildfly. So this is the GWT is trying to come up with the different solutions so that they can interop. So in this talk, I will focus on the resilience aspect of the microservices. So in the normal days, like if you have two services, it's a service A and a service C. If you know the service C is not reliable, what you do, like, okay, in your service A, in the calling, and like you can repeat a few times until it's a success. So use this this code. You can see a lot of boilerplate. You can do a for loop and just hope is within this five tries, and you can invoke the service C successfully. And this is showing how to use the macro profile fault tolerance programming model to achieve what you can achieve previously and even more. So this one is automatically saying this retry is kind of is the annotation, and also is kind of intercept binding. And it will say, okay, I want to do maximum five retries, only try maximum five. And whenever I got IO exception, I will retry. And each retry, I have a delay of 500 milliseconds. So you can see your application code, you don't need to pollute your application code. You just need to add the annotation there. Another thing is you should always have a timeout. You shouldn't wait indefinitely and when you're calling another service. And so the way to do it is use the macro profile fault tolerance is another annotation, the timeout, so you can specify what is the value. So this is the default unit is millisecond. This is 2,000 milliseconds. So the delay is 2 seconds. Within this 2 seconds, if you haven't got response, you will get a timeout exception. So you will get written. Another thing is we are all planning for the multi-threading and concurrency request, etc. The macro profile fault tolerance also provides a concept is book ahead. Basically, it will book ahead is originally was used in the ship term. So basically, it's trying to say the one part of the boat there's a failure, it shouldn't get a whole boat flooded. Basically, the one compartment is sealed from the rest of the compartments. So this is the idea. So bulkhead, basically, I can specify what's the maximum concurrent request I can to request the other service. So basically, the default value is 10. Basically, if you have more than 10, the other will wait. So you will not get a thread starvation issue. And if you use like without asynchronized, and so that means like it will use the semaphore style. So basically, if you get more requests, and then the other one will get a wait state. If you use it with asynchronized, so that will spin off a new thread. But you can also control how many threads you want. One of the very powerful aspects of the fault tolerance is the circuit breaker. So how many of you have known, has some basic understanding of circuit breaker? Okay, great. Yeah, when I first came to read about circuit breaker, it has the open, half open, closed. And you will think, like normally, if you think open, you will think open for business. However, in this term, if it's open, so it means broken. It means the circuit is open. So you have to think from the electrical perspective. So if it's said the circuit open, so that means no request can go through. So this is prevent from the repeating timeout. So previously, I say, okay, you can specify timeout and 2 seconds, but you don't want to every time wait for 2 seconds to get to the timeout. If after period of the failure, you want to fail immediately. Basically, you know that service is not responding. So that's why this is a circuit breaker. So basically, a circuit breaker can manage when to open the circuit. So after the circuit opened, no request will come through. Basically, the request will fail immediately. So this is a circuit open. So that means, so in this annotation is a circuit breaker. So it's when there's an I/O exception. You will get a circuit will be triggered, circuit breaker will be triggered. And it has some failure ratio, like the default is 20 rolling window, and then it's, the ratio is 0.5. So basically, if it's in the 20 rolling window, if it is 10 failures, your circuit will open. But after, but you don't want your circuit open all the time. So after a period, maybe the service is being repaired and then come back again. So that's why it's after some period, time period, you want to configure to say, okay, I want to give it another go. So that's why there's a delay, 500 milliseconds. So basically, there's a 500 milliseconds, and then I will get one request to go through to see whether the destination service is still responding. If it doesn't, I will go back to the open again. If it does, I will try again, and then you can configure the thread, success threshold, and to see if it's like continuous to success, and then your circuit back to close again. So this is the circuit breaker. A very, very important aspect in the fault tolerance is the fallback. So I know it's underlying the platform. For example, Istio. Have you heard of Istio? Okay, great. That's David. So Istio was is another open source project and created by IBM and Google and also Lyft. So it's we came together and come up with a new platform called Istio. It's kind of service mesh architecture. So it can offer some fault tolerance aspect. And however, any underlying platform can never do fallback. The reason is because only application developer understand the application. So only you, when you design the application, you know what is a sensible fallback it is. For example, if you want to subscribe to a movie, and the underlying platform have no idea what you are trying to do. So if the movie service is not responding, maybe it didn't give you the romantic movie, and then you can say, oh, okay, I can fall back to the detective movie, and etc. So you understand the application. So the fallback can never provide by anybody. Is only by you. So this is a macro profile for tolerance can do in your application when you call a service. If that service is not responding, and you can do the fallback. Like you can say you want a fallback to the my fallback that class, or you can say I can fallback to another method as well. So this is two ways. This is just showing one way. So as I mentioned earlier, you still can offer some of the aspect of the fault tolerance, but it cannot do the fallback. And one beauty of the macro profile fault tolerance is it can work beautifully with you still, because all this can be switched off by using one property file. Because they are all annotations, they are interceptor bindings. So I can provide one property, it can switch all the timeout, retry, circuit breaker, book except fallback. The reason is if you configure your application to have three retries, and you still configure about five retries, you end up will have how many retries you will have? You will end up with 15 retries, because when you call service C, and then you still say, okay, I call five times. And then another time you do retry, I call five times again. So, but is there's some libraries to achieve the fault tolerance aspect, like Hystrix or Failsafe. If you directly use these libraries, and you cannot use Istio's capability to achieve fault tolerance. But with this, it's very flexible. You can config. The other thing you can config is all the parameters on the annotation. They can be configured as well by using the property, configure property. So this is thing. So this is give you a quick overview about the metrics and the health. So health is macro profile health is exposed slash health endpoint, and then the metrics metrics provide slash metrics endpoint, so you can see the metrics data, have the service data, and also you can provide the application data as well. So this is a quick slide about how to achieve the security aspect. So it's use the microservice one and then trying to interrupt with the microservice two, and actually it's passing in the JSON web token, and they can communicate with the same security context. So I just touch on that. And then in the future, in the 1.3, we are trying to include the open tracing and open API, and also is the REST client API as well. So that's in the discussion. And this roadmap for the 2.0, maybe we can release later this year, or maybe we move to the first quarter next year. So this is the roadmap. And all the macro profile 1.2, fully implemented by OpenLibSy, so you can log on to the macroprofile.io, understand the programming model, and you can try the OpenLibSy. OpenLibSy is a complete open source, so it's we open up WebSphere Libsy to the whole community. So you can free to use, and you can even contribute as well. And this, if you want to understand a little bit more about macro profile programming model, there's a newsletter published by Eclipse in September. So I wrote a couple articles there. Do we have any time? So actually, I have some demo. So this is just show the I can't get it open. So this is a demo. Is I have two just a demo demonstrate what I have talked about. So service A over there, and then service C. So service A directly call into service C, and this is the two microservices all published to OpenLibT, and then the way to communicate is in the service A, I got to know the service C's endpoint. That's all I need to know, and I directly call into service C's the service, and then. In here, like get a property, no retry. If I directly poke, I lost the. I'm trying to move the. I'm having a difficult time here. Is that right, if I want to fresh, is that the right button? Oh no. So, is it sometimes is it not working? So, I can't, so this is not reliable service. So, I can take the code here. How can I in here? Gosh, I cannot move the mouse anymore. Because this project is not compatible with my computer. So, I got it. Okay, slowly. This is a not reliable service. So I can do. So if I do a with retry, if I save it. Can you see the mouse? Oh, it's so difficult. You have to believe me now. Must have messed up something. Okay, I think it's really difficult for me to bring it back. Oh, that's because here. Is that right now? So I have an extra open bracket. Yeah. So I can, when I save, I can directly do that. And then, see, I can retry it. Yeah, so thank you. That's really hard. Yeah, so with this, it's like you can tolerate any failures and et cetera, any unreliable stuff. Are there any questions?
Questions? So,
yeah.
Raise your hand if you have a question. You can also give a comment.
Okay.
Even
no questions, I quickly have a chat with the EE4D. I think it's David mentioned earlier in the Java 8 aspect. So EE4D. So Java EE will go to Eclipse. So, and also this macro profile is in Eclipse as well. So, and how these two things will fit together. EE4D is currently still in discussion, like it will settle in the Eclipse. However, the macro profile will still continue to release and pretend nothing happening and continue its own pace. However, when EE4J is everything fall into places, and maybe this two community has to talk and to see how best to make best of the use of resources and et cetera, how best to work together and et cetera. So there might be one day like a macro profile is still in Eclipse, and maybe one day macro profile is kind of falls under the EE4J. But this is all uncertainty and et cetera. If you, okay, this is another thing. So basically, if you want to have your voice heard, I echo what David said this morning, joining the E4G community, have the discussion as well. Has anybody used VS Code before? Oh, okay, great. In the OpenLibC, we built a really nice the VS Code, very nice Maven plugin. Just now I just saved the code and it automatically restart my application and you can see the results straight away. So I quickly show you the plugin you can use. So if you look at the poem, So you can look at the. So you can see this is the download OpenLibC. So OpenLibC 1703, and it's installed. And then this is the place like your service A directly invoke service C. So this is your property configuration. So you say you put the URL there, and in your application you directly use the config the macro profile config to inject into your class. So I can show you afterwards. So here is the Maven Libc, the Maven plugin. So the version 2.0, and it works beautifully. And if you want to create a Maven project, I strongly recommend you or Maven or Gradle project for your first or for your microservices. There's a tool called App Accelerator. So it's directly to be able to, if you choose like a macro profile, it's directly create a project for you. Has a JAX-S and a CDI and a GCP feature in it. So I show you briefly the. So you can see the this proxy here. So this is basically the how this is linked together. So this is the proxy class can directly invoke the one endpoint is exposed by the service C. So you can see that because I in the POM XML I configured the endpoint of service C in the bootstrapping that bracket. That's a section. So here, that will go automatically go to your system property. And here, I can directly inject that. I can see add inject and configure property. And then that name, servicec.url. And I got it straight away. And then I use the client builder, can directly, the JAX-S client can automatically invoke that target. So as you can see from here, I have a different mode, and then we have a different mode, and then you can invoke the service, and some service are not reliable. So you can check it out, and to see is I just trying to I think is this morning is. Fred, George talk about like IBM doesn't do microservices. I just trying to demonstrate actually the OpenLibC and support microservices and very well. So you can write very simple microservices. And we have a tooling to help you to develop microservices in Java. So this is as you can see, each service is quite small. Like service A is quite small, and service C is quite small as well. And basically, this is a naughty microservice. Just to demonstrate, you can do microservice using Java and use your current knowledge, Java E technology, and with the macro profile support, you can achieve your goal with your current knowledge. So you will stay in your job and. For many years to come. Okay, thank you.
We have a minute for a question. Is there any question? No hands? Okay, you can ask also Emily later.
Yeah.
Thank you, Emily.
Thank you.